we've got a transmission on a centroid and a center of gravity. Now, you know that when you define the center of gravity, it is that force that at a center of an object that tends to pull it downward. So, the force that at the center of an object or at a central point of that object is called a center of gravity. Each and every object, depending on its shape, has its own center of gravity where it's at. So I've written down each and every shape to show you where each center of gravity in the center is at, so that we can take it from there. Now, the difference between a centroid and a center of gravity, we define that the center of gravity is a point where your force acts in a body, your central point where your force acts in a body. Now, in this case of the center of gravity, you consider the mass of an object. It is big enough that you have to take into account your mass. So, for example, in this square, at the center of it, that is where your center of gravity acts. So, when your force, your weight of an object, they tend to pull it downward, that is where it will act, at the center of it. So, when you balance this force, your force due to your weight of an object is acting at the center. Now, the difference between the center of gravity and the centroid. Your centroid, your object, this is what we call the lamina. Your object is thin enough in such a way that you have to ignore the mass of this object. So it's just a very thin object. So your centroid is still the center of gravity, but for clarity purpose, we call the centroid with a symbol C. Center of gravity, you're gonna use a symbol G. In your centroid, you ignore it, you call it a lamina. The lamina is an object that is too thin in such a way that we have to ignore the mass of that object. In a centroid, we consider the mass of an object, but it's still a central point of a symmetric object. That is how you define your center of gravity. Now, each and every symmetric object has its own centroid and the center of gravity where it at. Now, for calculation purposes, you must know each and every shape, you must know where the center of gravity is, where the centroid is. I've written down all the shapes that we use for calculations again, and then I show you where the center of gravity each of an object at. Now, let's just start here on the centroid. There are four main shapes that you will look at the centroid. Your square and your rectangular. So I will do it concurrently because the centroid is in the same position. So when you look at this square, your centroid is acting at the center of your square. This is a breadth of a square, this is a height of a square. So in your centroid, you must know the area and the centroid where it is positioned. Now, when you want to find the centroid on your x-axis, you divide your breadth in two. So it's acting at the center, and then when you want to on your y-axis, you divide your height in two. So in other words, the centroid of your square and the rectangle is at the center of it. And when you calculate your area, it's breadth times height. It is important to know the area. I will tell you at the end of the lesson why it's important to know the area of each equation. In your side, the centroid acts at the center, so it's just a vector. So when you want your center of gravity going on your x-axis, you find your radius in the y, so it is in the same position. It's just a radius. And then this is how you can put your area of a cycle. Same cycle, your centroid, when you're looking at your x-axis, it is equal to your radius. And when you're looking at your y-axis, it is 0.424 multiplied by your radius. So this is a center, this is where they meet your x and the y, it's where you find your centroid. Now, this one is very tricky. You must know that your y cannot always be 0.424. It depends on how your cycle is positioned. You might find a cycle that stands in this position. And then your central detector is center there. Now, which the one that was the y here is now your x. And then the one that was your x is now your y. Meaning, in this case, your x. Is 0.424 r, and then your y is equal to your radius. In other words, what you must know is the position of your centroid. This cannot always be y. If you turn this look like vertical, this is what will be x, this is what will be y. So your centroid, you must just know its position on your steady side. So you've cut your side in here. You must know that from where you cut your side to your centroid is 0.424 r. It either it's x or y, it will depend how your sinusoid is positioned. So this is very important to understand the right hand triangle. This is where your centroid is. From 90 degrees, when you want your x axis to be 0.4, I mean it will be a breadth divided by 3, and then on your y, it is your height divided by 3. That is where your centroid is. This is your centroid. And then this is how you calculate the area of your centroid. Now, and you must know that this is how I refer to it there. This from your edge to your centroid, from your edge to your centroid. In this case, you might have to find your centroid coming from this position. You might find your centroid coming from this position, meaning you must know the distance from this edge to your centroid, but we're still gonna discuss that. This is where your centroid goes, your right edge, changing edge. You must know where your centroid is, and then you must be able to calculate your area. Let's just take a center of gravity. The center of gravity of a square in your rectangular, it is at a center there. On our center of gravity, since we consider the mass, we must know the volume. Then this is how you calculate your volume, length times spread times height of your square or rectangular. If you consider your 3D, remember here, when you consider two sides, it's your area. Here you consider your 3D because it is a big size, enough that you consider the mass of this object. For your sphere, this is your ball. Your center of gravity is at a center, so it is equal to your radius. And this is how you calculate the volume of your sphere. You must memorize how you calculate the volume of your sphere. Hemisphere, which is a half a sphere there. Now if you look at half a sphere, from where you cut your sphere to your center of gravity, that is where your center of gravity is. So there, from your center to your center of gravity, your x going in your x axis is equal to your radius, but your y is equal to 3 over 8 r. So you multiply radius with 3 over 8 to find from this position to that position. Once again, it might flip. This will always depend how your hemisphere is positioned. So in other words, from your center where you cut your sphere to your center of gravity is 3 over 8 r, and then when you're looking at your x axis, your center of gravity is x from your edge to where your center of gravity is based for is equal to your radius. If you flip it and then it looks like this, again your x has changed. Your x now will be 3 over 8 r, and your y will be equal to your radius. So you must be careful of that. This is just a condition of your center of gravity. From your edge to your center of gravity, and from your edge to your center of gravity. The last one is a cone. The cone, your center of gravity, when you're looking at your x symmetrically, so your center of gravity is equal to your radius, and then your y is 8 over 4. And therefore, this is how you calculate the volume of your cone. You must memorize the volume there. 1 over 3 multiplied by pi over 4 is quite that. And then this is the center of gravity of your cylinder. And this is your x and your y of your cylinder. In other words, the center of gravity of your cylinder is acting at the center. This is what you need to know before you do your calculations. Each and every shape, you must know where the center of gravity is, and you must be able to calculate your area for each and every shape there. Now, say it's easy to find the center of gravity if you only didn't meet one shape, as in a case here, when you only didn't meet one shape. Now, let's just look at a complex object. Your object, which has more than one shape, say you have an object of this kind. Alright. Now, it's easy to find your central, your center of gravity, if you only deal with one shape. Now, say you have this complex object. When you're looking at this object, you have a rectangular, you have your semicircle, you have a right angle triangle. You don't know where is the exact the center of gravity of this one, but you know that if you are only dealing with this rectangular, the center of gravity should have been there, your centroid position should have been there. If you are only dealing with this semicircle, the centroid should have been in this position. If you are only dealing with this right angle triangle, your centroid will be in this position. Now, you can't say it's acting on a position of your square of your rectangle. You can't say it's acting on your side. You can't say it's acting on your right angle triangle. When you have a complex object like this, meaning you have more than one shape of your area in your object, or one shape of your 3D diagrams, then you can't be able to find the center of gravity. In this case, that is where you will be using your area and your center of gravity for each. Before you be able, so you must be able to apply a certain calculation to determine where exactly is your center of gravity acting when you have an object as complex as that one. How are you going to approach this type of problem when you need the center of gravity? You must be able to be able to identify how many shapes you have in terms of your area. You have this first shape, which is your rectangular, and then you label it 1. You have this hole, you label it 2. You have this right angle triangle, you label it 3. So you now identify that, okay, I have my 3 shapes. In each of the 3 shapes, your first one, you know that your center of gravity was in this position. This was your X, which we call it your XY. This was your Y, which was supposed to be your Y1. And the center of gravity of your hole was here. So from your edge to your center of gravity, this was your Y2. And then from your centroid again to your edge, there it had back. This was supposed to be your X2. Your X3, this was supposed to be X3 from that edge. This is X3. And then this is Y3. So, when you want to identify the center of gravity when you have more than one shape, you must identify the center of gravity for each, and then you apply your moment of your loaded. You say sum of your moment is equal to your product of your area, meaning your total area, multiply by your center of gravity, which is your X or your Y bar. In other words, sum of your moment, meaning your sum of your area, multiply by your center of gravity for each, your X and your Y for each, is equal to your X bar or your Y bar, which is your exact center of gravity where your X acts or where your Y acts. You don't know where it is right now, but it still tells you that area 1 plus X1 plus or minus area 2 X2 plus or minus area 3 X3 is equal to total area multiplied by your X bar if you're dealing with your X. So this is the law that you have to use. If you're making your X bar, if you're looking for the subject of the formula, it will say your X bar is equal to area 1, X1, plus or minus area 2, X2, plus or minus area 3, X3, divided by total area, which is area 1, plus or minus area 2, plus or minus area 3. Now, if you apply this formula, when you find this X bar, you find exactly where the center of gravity is. When you find your Y bar using this law, then you find exactly where your Y bar is. In other words, sum of your moment is equal to your product of your area multiplied by your X and your Y bar from each edge. Now, you will notice that you will have to take a reference now, because you're now taking your moment. either you take it from your left, so it's somewhere from your left edge or your right edge, when you're looking for your edge bar. In this case, my reference is this one. I will call it XX. And then on my Y bar, my reference is the bottom, this one, which I call it YY. Now, you must be able, once, when you're taking your moment here, it is actually, you say the area of this shape, the big shape, multiplied by a distance from your centroid to your edge, where, which is your reference. When I'm looking for my X, my position of my centroid on my X bar, I'm looking for your X bar, where the centroid is. That means I will say my first shape is my rectangular. It will be area of a rectangular multiplied by a distance from a centroid of my rectangular to my reference, to one of my edges, either my left or my right edge. Your first one, your centroid, your edge is your left edge. So the distance from the centroid to that one, you say it's x1. Plus or minus, you say plus or minus. Your positive sign, it means that your area is added. Your negative sign, it means that it's removed. I've even written here that it's a hole. Your hole is the removed part. So the formula said plus or minus because it's either you add in that area, you subtract it in. In this case, we're subtracting our hole. So it will be minus area of a hole. You calculate the area of a hole. Here is the area of a semi side there. This is how you calculate the area of a semi of a semi-side, pi r squared divided by 2. And then once you find your area, the position, your x3, your x number 2 is the position from your centroid. Here is the position of my centroid to where I'm taking my reference. So you must know the distance from my centroid to where you're taking your reference. Now, when you're looking at this half a side, it's standing like this. That is your centroid there. The distance that you know is this one that comes from here to this edge. This distance is 0.424 r. Meaning, once you know this distance, you subtract it with this a to be able to calculate the distance from here to where you're taking your moment towards your edge. That is why I told you that this one, actually, what you know is this distance. The distance from your edge to your centroid. But in this case, your x3 is not from this edge to your centroid. You need to know from your centroid to where you take your moment, to that position. So this is where it helps you to know the position of your centroid. Once you know the position of your centroid, then you'll be able to know the distance from your centroid to where you take your moment. Yeah. So you know the side. You can't say your x2 is equal to radius or is 0.424 r. This 0.424 r is a distance from here to here, but you're not looking from the distance from this position to that position. You're looking from distance from that position to your edge. This is your edge then. So that is your x number 2. In your x number 3, your centroid of your edge triangle, it's from here. What you know is that from this position to this edge is b over 3. So you will get the distance from here to this edge plus c. This is d plus c. So you know the distance from here to here because you know that on your right hand triangle from here to that position is b over 3, and then you're not taking your moment from this position. You always take your moment from among the edges. So it's a distance from your centroid to that edge that you might identify. So this edge, b over 3, is helping you to know the distance from here to here, plus the distance from there because you want the total distance. Just like when you take your moment on your beam, it's always from your dead position to where you take your moment. This is where you take your moment. Yeah. Same thing with a Y bar, when you deal with your Y bar. When you deal with your Y bar, it will be your Y bar is equal to A1, Y1 minus A2, Y2 plus A3, Y3 all over total area, which is A1 minus A2 plus A3. Remember, your hole is the removed one to the negative. This is a general equation that you find in the formula sheet. And then you need to look at the structure and everything training, whether in that side is it positive or negative. Your removed load is negative. So this is a final equation. In this was negative, this was positive, this was negative, this was positive. So this is the final formula. But in the formula sheet, it will be plus or minus, it's showing you that it will end up being removed or added part. Your right hand side is added, your whole is removed, so it's negative, this one is positive. So this is the final formula. Again, you're taking a moment from your bottom. You might be able to, you might be required to take a moment from the top. You might be able to take a moment from your right when you're looking for your X bar, from the top when you're looking for the Y bar. In our case, our reference is our bottom, and our reference for your Y bar, our reference is from your left on our X bar. So it's area 1, Y1, area 2, Y2, a position from my centroid number 2 to where I'm getting my Y2. Area 3, your right leg triangle and the position from my centroid to where I'm taking my mama divided by total area. That is, now, when you get your X bar and the Y bar, you will be where they meet, it shows you the centroid. So in our case, we don't know the centroid is yet. This will give you your centroid on your X bar. This will give you the centroid on your Y bar. And then you come up with this formula. And this equation is not limited here. It can continue, depending how many shapes we find. You can have area 4, X4, area 5, X5, depending on the shape that you have. But in a nutshell, you need to know in each and every material, each and every symmetric object, where is your center of gravity, your centroid and the center of gravity, out of this shape. If you have your cone under your centroid, you have a cone like this. Your cone is symmetrical. Your centroid is somewhere here. This is your breadth. This is your height. For your cone, your x is equal to b over 2. Your y is equal to h over 3. And your area is half breadth times height. So you must add that shape, this shape of a cone under your centroid. Maybe you have all the shapes that you might find. You know that I'm only limiting it to your N4 work, but you have many shapes that you might find under your prisms and that one of your areas. But I'm only going to limit it here. This is a shape that you need to know before you do your calculations. Each and every shape, know the same. Know where you get your centroid, know how to calculate your area, know how to get your center of gravity, where your center of gravity is positioned, how you calculate your volume. And then we're going to apply this law. Remember, if we're dealing with your prisms like this one, maybe the hemisphere and your cone mounted together, we do the same thing. But instead of an area, you put a volume. And then you check whether the part is removed or it's added, but it's the same formula. We'll see when you do an example under your centroid and the center of gravity. But for now, under your lesson, this is what you need to know. Each and every area, know the where your center of gravity or centroid is positioned. That is very important. And then you apply this law to calculate the center of gravity if you have more than one. Thank you for watching the video. So now I'm gonna upload an example. One example on my center and one example on my center of gravity. Thank you.